Hey church, service is about to start in just a few minutes, so grab that last cup of coffee, wrap up that conversation, go use the restroom, and then head over into the auditorium and grab a seat. We're gonna be starting in just a minute or two. We'll see you inside. Thank you.
parents, as service begins here in just a few minutes, we want you to know that we got your back. If your infant or little one starts to get a little noisy during the service, we have an overflow room right around the corner. There are couches and TVs for you to enjoy the service in a room that's a bit more comfortable for you and your little one. Just look for the room that says Activity Center and make yourself at home.
Well, good morning, church. It is great to see everybody. I hope that you guys are excited to be in church today. How many of you are excited to be in church today? All right, praise the Lord. Let's stand to our feet. We're going to sing out this morning. It says, "Let me tell you about my Jesus."
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all it's stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah.
price for all my guilty. Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh.
Come on, church, let's sing it out.
He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me.
Morning that you can say Jesus has changed my life. You can go ahead and have a seat this morning. In fact, we have many today who are saying we're coming this morning to let you know that Jesus has changed our lives. We are so excited that we have the opportunity to celebrate with those who are following Christ in baptism this morning. We have many who are following in this service. And in the next service, we're going to turn our attention to the screens and then push it to the lobby, and they're going to lead us in baptism this morning.
Good morning, church family. Welcome to Desert Hills this morning. We're excited to participate in several people being baptized this morning, and we understand that baptism is an outward expression of an inward decision. The Bible says in Romans 6, it says, "Therefore are we buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life." Baptism lets people know that we already walk in newness of life. And we have several today coming to profess their faith in believer's baptism. Would you come this morning? This is Olivia. Olivia, have you received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? In obedience to our Lord's command and upon your public profession of faith in him, hold your nose. I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. You got it? All right, watch your step. You got it? This is Eric. Eric Monterusso. Eric, have you received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? In obedience to our Lord's command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Do you want your glasses on or off? Off. This is Kayla. Kayla Hernandez. Kayla, have you received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? In obedience to our Lord's command and upon your public profession of faith in him, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Congratulations. Got it. This is Jimena. Jimena Hernandez. Jimena, have you received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? In obedience to our Lord's command and upon your public profession of faith in him, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Congratulations. We have Caden coming to be baptized this morning. What's up, Caden? Caden, have you received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
And upon your public profession of faith in him, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. You walk in newness of life. This is Reagan, Caden's sister. Gotcha. Reagan, have you received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Upon your public profession of faith in him, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. Thank you very much.
Amen. Praise the Lord for what he is doing. I'll tell you what, we live in a world where it just seems like things are sheer chaos around us. And like, there's so many things we look at and we're like, yeah, young people these days, and who knows what's going on. And I'll tell you what, we are privileged to be in a church that has the opportunity to see people choosing to follow Christ with their lives. Amen. Praise the Lord for that. Church, let's all stand together. We're going to sing that chorus again. It says, he makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Sing it out with us.
He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus, and let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah, 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 amen, amen. Hallelujah, 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 amen. Jesus, change your life.
Good morning, Desert Hills, and welcome again. Thank you for being here, and you can have a seat. And it's just been an incredible day so far, seeing that many young people. You imagine all those young people coming forward in believers' baptism. Incredible. Kind of like Pastor David was saying, there is hope. There's hope. Jesus is still changing lives, and we're excited to be a part of that here at Desert Hills. So let me say thank you for being here. If this is your first time here, thank you as well. If there's any way we can serve you while you are here, please let us know. In the seat back in front of you, you'll found a Connect card, looks like that, and please fill that out, and then we'd love to snatch that from you after the service in our lobby at our guest services station. It's right underneath that big New Here sign, and take that Connect card over there. They'll exchange it for one of our wonderful gifts, and we'd love to put that into your hands just as a thank you for being here. If this is your first, your second, or even your third time here, or if you've been here a couple months, you've never filled one out, we'd love to hear from you, get some feedback from you there as well. We're looking forward to just a great Sunday, and obviously a lot of things going on in this spring season as we're moving into the summer season. So let's turn our attention to the screens and see some of the upcoming events at Desert Hills.
Ladies, our spring event is taking us to the Kentucky Derby, and it's almost here. Next Saturday, April 27th, our ladies event is open for ladies of all ages, and we'll have a blast with great food, activities, and spiritual encouragement hosted here at the church campus. You can register on the app, or if you prefer, stop by the lobby and you can sign up there as well. This morning's generosity tip for the day is simple. Give consistently. Consistent giving is more than a financial transaction. It's an expression of our commitment to God and our community. It allows us to sustain our ministries, support those in need, and maintain our sacred space for worship and fellowship. We encourage you to consider becoming a consistent giver, especially during the summer months when vacations, sports, and family activities can throw off our rhythm of giving. Your regular contributions, whether big or small, make a significant impact on our ability to serve and uplift others. So this morning, determined to give consistently this summer. That's your generosity tip for the day. Our next Grief Share group will meet for 13 consecutive weeks, beginning Monday, April 29th. We invite anyone that has lost someone they love, friend or family member, to sign up for this group. Being a part of GriefShare not only equips you with tools and strategies to help you move forward after a loss, sign up to join us, or if you know someone that might benefit, please let them know.
Church, please stand and join us in continuing worship.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. Thumbs up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name.
Your rich in love and Your slow to anger.
The beginning
One with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Chapter 2 says, wherefore God hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow and every tongue confess.
Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, the silence, the bones of sin and grave, the heaven. The praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Father, this morning, we worship you. You have a beautiful name, the name of Jesus, the name at which one day every single one of us will bow and worship. Not because we have to, although we will have to, but out of sheer admiration and praise and worship to you, the God of the universe. Lord, we thank you for being so good to us. Man, we celebrate already. It's been a great service so far. We've had the opportunity to sing about you and what you've done in our lives, to sing directly to you, to worship your name. Lord, to celebrate with those who are saying, I'm giving my life to Jesus Christ and I want everybody to know about it. God, you are working in our world. You are working in our city. You are working in our church. And we thank you for that. May you be high and lifted up in this place today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Morning, church family. Welcome to our 8:45 service, and it has been a blessing so far. What a blessing it was to see a number of young people trust Jesus Christ as their Savior and then profess their faith today in believers' baptism. We're excited about that. And then we also are excited about, we had a number of people in our membership class this last weekend, and they're coming to unite, many of them, with our church in membership. These are people that already have been saved and have a profession of faith in believers' baptism following their salvation and want to be a part of what God is doing here at Desert Hills. And I'm going to name the names here. If you are here in this service, we have people that will be announced in both services. So some people may be in the 10:30 service, and I understand that they won't raise their hand because they're going to be in the next service. But if you're in this service, if you just raise your hand and let us know you're here, Armando and Crystal Martinez. I thought I saw them here. Armando and Crystal Martinez. Let's give. We'll give everybody a hand in just a moment. Armando and Crystal Martinez. Lonnie and Carrie Atkinson. Javier and Lily Hernandez. Okay, there we are. I see them there. Let's see here. James and Crystal Cruzy. Right here, I got that, James. Did you get to see that? Stephanie Ornales. All right. Jadar and Mercedes Irvin. Janet Uma. Michael and Anna Knowles. Jason and Araceli Kaleli. All right, here on this side. And Victor Baxter. Vic Baxter. All right. Let's see here. Jerome and Yolanda Cruz. All right, right here. Tim and Tiffany Prius. I saw them somewhere right over here. And Hyacinth Williams. Let's all give them a hand this morning. And if you see them, welcome them to our congregation. Let them know that you're glad to have them as a part of Desert Hills. If you're in a small group with any of these, please do the same. And we're excited about small groups. They started this last week, and a number of people are involved and signed up, and we're excited about what God is doing through that. And we're excited to get in the series this morning as we look here in Acts chapter 3. If you have your Bibles this morning, Acts chapter 3, we're going to go until chapter 4 in verse 4 this morning. The title of my message is The Beautiful Miracle. Now, on the Mount of Transfiguration, Peter and James and John were so caught up in what was happening, they wanted to stay in the moment. In fact, the Bible says Jesus was transfigured before them, Matthew chapter 17, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment or his clothes were white as light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then answered Peter and said unto Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. Wow, oh, this is so good. If you will allow us, let us make here three tabernacles, one for you, Jesus, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah. In other words, this is such a great moment, Jesus. Let's stay in the moment by building a tabernacle for you and for Moses and for Elijah. It would have been easy for the disciples here in Acts to relish the awe-inspiring moments they had just witnessed as the Holy Spirit took up residence within them and demonstrated that residence by cloven tongues of fire. They could have cultivated a club-like spirit. Let's all gather around. Let's all reminisce about what God has done, what God is doing. Let's all give us each other that a boys. Let's just live in this moment. And they could have smothered the fire of God's Spirit that was wanting to work through them. But they did not. They wanted to share what they had experienced with the world. Now, some might say the main influence in Acts chapter 1 and 2 is the Holy Spirit. They were waiting for the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 1. Jesus told them the Holy Spirit was going to come, and after he came, they were going to be empowered to carry out the gospel to Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. And when he indwells them in Acts chapter 2, he makes an indelible impression on them, and people come to Jesus Christ by what the Holy Spirit allowed to happen. The main influence, however, in Acts chapter 3 through Acts chapter 6 is none other than Satan himself. Now, he's only identified by name once, but it's evident that he was at work to bring about opposition from outside of the church, which would lead to persecution and confusion within the church that would cause problems. In fact, Peter confronts a man by the name of Ananias in Acts chapter 5 and says, "Why has Satan filled your heart to lie against the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land?" Satan could not read Ananias's mind, but he could and does fill hearts with things contrary to God's will and to God's truth. And at every turn throughout the book of Acts, Satan uses circumstances, Satan uses leaders, and Satan will even use God's people to stand before what God is trying to do in and through his people and through his church. But here in Acts 3, although Satan was at work behind the scenes, God was about to work in the most beautiful way. So we see this morning the miracle that God allowed. And the miracle took place as Peter and John were going to pray. Notice in Acts chapter 3 and verse 1, the Bible says, "Now when Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour." Now the disciples had not totally broken from Judaism. So as with all devout Jews, Peter and John went to the temple during a designated prayer time just after the priests would have given the evening sacrifices at 3 p.m., the ninth hour. It was the busiest of all the prayer times. So the greatest amount of people would have been present at the temple. It is interesting to note that God often allows us to be used of him when we're already seeking to fulfill his purpose. People have complained to me over the years about not sensing or seeing God at work in their lives, but I will say it's hard to for God to work when we're not allowing Him already to be a conduit through us. It's hard for God to speak to us if we're not availing ourselves to His Word. It's hard for us to get answers from God if we're not availing ourselves to pray. It's hard for our kids to know the truth if we're not trying to instill into them the truth of the Word of God. And sometimes we blame God for things that obviously are not His fault. It's hard for people to get saved that are close to us if we won't open our mouths to witness to them. Now, this wasn't the case for Peter and John. They had experienced the indwelling of the Holy Spirit and were riding a spiritual high and wanted to get closer to God who had filled them. So we find them at the temple at the ninth hour when it was prayer time. And as we look at the miracle, we see Peter and John's interaction with the beggar. They were approaching the temple near, but this is what it would have looked like. This is what the Temple Mount looks like now. It's still exists, the place where Solomon's temple and the temple, Herod's temple, would have existed. This is what it looks like now. I think we have a picture of that. This is what it would look like back then. We have a picture of what it looks like, I think, with the Dome of the Rock there. There it is. This is what it looks like now. The Al-Aqsa Mosque is right there on the one side. It looks like the north side. And then you can see what is left of the Temple Mount. Now, back in Peter's day, it would have looked like this. This is the diagram of what it would have looked like. You have gates all around the temple, and then you can see the temple itself on the north side of the picture. And that's what it all would have consisted of. There would have been storehouses. There would have been rooms where they kept sacrifices. There would have been rooms where certain women were allowed, and men were allowed, and Gentiles were allowed, and so on. And this is what it would have looked like during this time. And there's a part on the one side where it would have been known as Solomon's colonnade, which we're going to talk about in just a bit. But this is what the place was. Jewish historian Josephus wrote about this gate, the beautiful gate, and said, "The gate was greater and more valuable than all other gates that were only covered with silver and gold. The gate was adorned after a most costly manner, having much richer and thicker plates of silver and gold upon it. The beautiful gate was 50 cubits tall, or 82 feet high." Imagine that. 15 meters taller, or 50 feet taller than the other gates. Opening the gate required 20 men. Think about that. The gate was made of Corinthian brass, imported from a great distance to Jerusalem and overlaid with silver and gold. Now, even though a man could create such a beautiful gate, man could not improve the condition of the beggar mentioned here. And the Bible tells us a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered the temple. Now, the Jews looked down most likely on this man, supposing that this man was lame as a result of his sin. Or maybe he was lame as a result of the sin of his parents. But God was going to use this man to display His power and allow Peter an opportunity to preach about Jesus. So as Peter and John are about to walk into the entrance of the beautiful gate, the beggar seizes an opportunity to ask alms of them. And in Judaism, almsgiving was a meritorious art. So the man's position at Israel's religious center and their most prominent gate would have profited him well. So he's there, alms, alms, alms for the poor. Peter tells the man to look on them, and now the man's expecting to receive something. The Bible tells us who seen Peter and John about to go into the temple asked an alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, "Look on us." And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have I give unto thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." Peter lets the poor man know that he doesn't have silver and gold, much to his disappointment, but offered him something more valuable than money. And so we see the healing of the beggar. "In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. I'm not sure if there was a pause or if the man looked at Peter quizzically like, what is going on? What are you talking about, Peter? But then Peter decides to lead in the situation, and the Bible tells us, and he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and his ankle bones received strength. Now, the one recording this is none other than Dr. Luke. Luke, the author of the book of Acts, the human hand in the book of Acts, was a physician. And so physicians are all about details. And it's interesting how Luke records immediately his feet and his ankle bones received strength. The man was lame from birth. He didn't know what it was like to walk. His ankles and feet were probably gnarled and misshapen. And in a moment, in an instant, they became normal. They received strength, and his ankles and his feet and his toes were placed back into their sockets and then looked normal. And the Bible says, and he leaping up stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. Can you imagine? He didn't have to be taught how to walk. His healing wasn't gradual, nor does it even indicate that he had this great degree of faith. But he was healed instantaneously and completely. And when he entered the temple with Peter and John, he entered walking and leaping and praising God, and he was filled with joy. And the Bible says, and all the people saw him walking and praising God. So God used this miracle to authenticate the ministry of the apostles. It was God who healed the man. God used Peter in the healing, all to give Peter an opportunity to ultimately preach the gospel. And the Bible says, and they that knew it, they knew it was he that sat at alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which happened unto him. Now, Peter and John healed this man without fanfare. They didn't need an atmosphere. They didn't have to have loud rushing music in the background. They didn't have to have the crowds cheering, come on, come on, come on, come on. They didn't have any of that. In fact, we don't see a crowd present who was paying attention to the situation at all. Every indication was that the man did not have a great degree of faith. He was expecting money, and instead he got healed. Peter and John were simply on their way to pray. Now, much of the supposed faith healing that happens today, the faith healers will tell you, requires an atmosphere. The crowd has to be present, and the ones to be healed need to have a great degree of faith. Over the years, I've met these people that have claimed to have the ability to heal people. God has given them the ability to heal. And I'll always ask them questions. I'll say, tell me about it. Tell me about your faith healing. And they'll explain to me what is happening, what God does through them. And they want to defer credit to God. But then when I say something like this, hey, listen, I was just at San Antonio Community Hospital this morning, or I was just at Kaiser Hospital in Fontana, or I was just at this hospital, Banner University. Would you like to go with me and meet some of these people that are sick and that have cancer and that are dealing with ailments that seemingly are incurable? Would you like to go with me and visit somebody that has pancreatic cancer and literally they only have days to live? If you have the ability to heal people, let's go. And they'll always have some excuse as to why they can't. Well, it requires a great degree of faith. Well, believe me, if anybody has faith, these people have faith. Well, I need an atmosphere. Jesus didn't need an atmosphere. And it's interesting to note that people that today claim that God gave them the ability to heal people, they're not using that gift to empty the hospitals. Now, do I believe God heals people today? I sure do. I sure do believe that God can heal people, not me, not somebody else's hand, but God can. I have seen him do it. I had doctors say to my wife and I that the baby she was carrying had no chance of living, did not have kidneys, did not have a bladder. If we went on with the pregnancy, my wife ran the risk of hemorrhaging and dying, and basically looked at us like we were stupid. We went on with the pregnancy. They gave us no chance. They said when the baby's umbilical cord was cut, she would die. She would be lifeless within a few moments. And they cut that cord, and she kept crying. And she's been crying for 26 years. I believe God can heal. And I believe He does. It's not always His will to heal people. On Easter Sunday morning, one of my friends died. He was a deacon at our church, and he was my friend. I went to see him the Wednesday before Easter, Pastor Matt and myself. And he was a man probably of 6'2" or 6'3". A good-sized man, and probably was down to 100 pounds. He could barely communicate. He wanted to be well. In the month of May, he and his wife would have celebrated 50 years of marriage. I wanted him to be well. I wanted them to be able to celebrate that time together. He's my friend. She's my friend. Did he have faith? Of course he had faith. Even in those last moments, his heart was hopeful. His mind was set on God. He was assured that God could do anything. But you know what? God's will was not to heal him in this sense of physical healing, to make him well on this side of glory, but God has healed him now. You see, if someone has the gift of healing today, why aren't the hospitals empty? God gave Peter and the apostles the ability to heal, and there was no question as to the authenticity of the healing. Now, it's not always that way today. How many of you remember COVID? You remember COVID 2020? Well, in 2020, there is this famous school that supposedly has the School of Healing, Bethel Church. Northern California, Bethel Music, Bethel Church, they supposedly have the School of Healing, and they're supposedly famous for putting out people that have the gift of healing and go around healing people. But when COVID hit, the School of Healing closed out of fears of COVID. Something's wrong with that picture. The irony is great. You see, that wasn't the case for what was going on in Acts chapter 3. We see not only the miracle God allowed, but we see the message Peter preached. The Bible says, "And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's Great Wondering." Peter and John had gone to the area of the temple known as Solomon's Colonnade to pray. It looked something like this back in the Bible days. This big area where people could assemble. I think we got it here this morning. And as they were there, the man who had been lame was hanging on to them, no doubt bewildered, no doubt full of wonder, no doubt full of gratitude. And as this was going on, the crowd began to gather, turning their focus on the man who was lame and Peter. Remember, this was the busiest time of the temple. And notice Peter's response. "And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, 'You men of Israel, why marvel you at this, or look you on us so steadfastly, as though we by our own power or holiness has made this man to walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers hath glorified his son Jesus.'" And then notice verse 16. "And his name, through faith in his name, hath this man made strong, whom you see and know. Yea, the faith which is by him hath given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all." You see, as people began to focus on Peter, Peter deflected their focus back to God and to Jesus Christ. Notice again, why look you so earnestly on us as though by our own power or holiness we have made this man to walk? Peter clearly wanted the crowd to know that this beautiful miracle did not originate with him. It wasn't his power. It wasn't his specialness that gave this man who'd never walked a day in his life the ability to rise up and walk. He points them to the one who gave this man that opportunity, the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob. The God of our fathers hath glorified his son, Jesus Christ. And in verse 16, he affirms it. Peter's expression of God, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, hath glorified his son, expressed his conviction that what was new in Jesus was in total continuity with everything that God had already said in the Old Testament. Jesus was the fulfillment of Old Testament prophecies, and faith in Jesus' name has made this man to walk. Peter didn't want anything to be about Peter. He wanted everything to be about Jesus. Now, in the Gospel of John, John the Baptist was still alive and not yet imprisoned. And John's fame began to, Jesus' fame began to grow, and Jesus was baptizing in an area known as Ainon. The followers of John the Baptist came to John and asked John what he thought about Jesus' name growing and John's influence diminishing, and here's John the Baptist's reply. In fact, my prayer and my life's verse is John 3:30. John said this, "He, Jesus, must increase. I, John, must decrease." He, Jesus, must increase. I, John, must decrease. Now, we all would do ourselves a world of good if we deflected attention away from ourselves in any accomplishment and turned that attention back to Jesus. That's what Peter did. You see, it'll keep us from pride. It'll keep our focus off ourselves and keep it right on Jesus. We see then in the message, Peter confronted the people about Jesus. You see, the Jews during this time prided themselves in their righteousness. They prided themselves in their adherence, their keeping of the law, their conformity to Jewish tradition. And Peter wanted each of them to take responsibility for what had happened to Jesus. And so he writes, we see written in verse 13, "Whom you delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. But you denied the Holy One and the Just One and desired a murderer to be granted unto you and killed the Prince of Life whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses." Peter makes three accusations against the people, not to belittle them, not to try to stand above them in judgment, but so that they could see their lostness, understanding their guilt and their need of salvation. He says, "You delivered Jesus to the Romans." And then he told them, "You denied Jesus in the presence of Pilate. He was about to let Jesus go, and you said, 'Give us Barabbas.'" And then he writes, or you see written, "You killed the Prince of Life, who is now raised from the dead." The fact of the matter is, before anybody can be saved, they have to recognize that they are lost. Romans 3:10 says, "As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one." And then between Romans 3:10 and on, it says things like, "There is none that understandeth, there is none that seeketh after God, they are all gone out of the way, they are altogether become unprofitable, there is none that doeth good, no, not one, their throat is like an open sepulcher, the poison of asp is under their lips, their tongue is full of bitterness and vile," and so on. And then it comes and sums it up here in verse 19. "Now we know that the things whatsoever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God." And then it says, "Therefore by the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin." You could never keep every one of the Ten Commandments, nor could I, nor could anyone. And the only one that ever fulfilled that opportunity was Jesus Christ himself. And the law, what it was given for, is it was given to help us understand we're sinners, we're guilty before God, we need a Savior. That's why the law was given. And so Peter wanted them to understand their lostness. Peter needed to make it clear that their supposed righteousness was not displayed when they delivered and denied and had Jesus Christ murdered. Now, Peter understood why they did it. In fact, Peter makes the point that they did it through ignorance. In verse 17, "And now, brethren, I wot not that through ignorance he did it, as did also your rulers." Now, his purpose in saying this was not to excuse their sin, nor to imply forgiveness was unnecessary, but to convey that he understood how it could happen. After all, Peter himself denied Jesus Christ in Jesus' direst hour of need. And then we see Peter explains that Jesus was the foretold Messiah and fulfillment of biblical prophecies. Now, most people that were here were waiting for a political Messiah who would set them free from the shackles of Rome. But Jesus was a Messiah with a spiritual kingdom. They had a hard time processing and understanding this, so Peter refers them to the prophets that foretold of how the Messiah would come. He says in verse 18, "But those things which God before hath showed by the mouth of all of his prophets that Christ should suffer, he hath so fulfilled." Isaiah said it. He would be wounded for our transgressions. He would be bruised for our iniquities. And by his stripes we would be healed. He would have nor form nor comeliness nor anything that we would desire in him. Others, Zechariah and Joel and others prophesied about how Jesus would come. And Peter says, "For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you and your brethren like unto me. Him shall ye hear in all things whatsoever he shall say unto you. And it shall come to pass that every soul which will not hear that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. Yea, and all the prophets from Samuel and those that follow after, as many of have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. Ye are the children of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, and in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed." In Genesis 12, God told Abraham that he was going to use Abraham's seed to bless the world. That was a promise of the Messiah. Jesus was the blessing to the world as the offspring of Abraham. And from Abraham the prophet unto Jesus, Jesus was foretold to come as the Messiah and suffer and establish his kingdom. And then we see Peter calls out the people to repent and receive the blessing of Jesus. Peter tells the people who have gathered to understand how the lame man was healed and to repent of what they have done and who they have believed upon and to become believers in Jesus and to be converted. Notice what it says, "Repent you therefore and be converted." And then he tells them several blessings they will receive if they receive Jesus as their Messiah. Their sins would be wiped away, that your sins will be blotted out. You see, back in these days, when you wrote with ink, the ink didn't have acid in it. So when we write with ink today, that acid in the ink etches into the paper. But in the Bible days, as they wrote with ink, that ink would stay on top of the papyrus that they would write upon. And if somebody wanted to, they could get a wet rag or they could get a sponge and they would get that sponge wet and they could literally wipe whatever was written down right off the paper. And Peter says, if you receive Jesus Christ, your sins will be wiped away. Now, aren't you glad that the Bible says in Psalms, as far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Some of you are still living in the past. Maybe there was a time that you were an angry person. Maybe there was a time when you were a fornicator. Maybe there was a time when you were a bitter person. Maybe there was a time where you were any number of things. and you're living in that past. Your identity is tied to the sins of your past. Your identity is tied to what you were before you were in Jesus Christ, and you can't get past that. And Satan uses it every chance he can get to speak into your ear and say, that's who you are. But as Peter said, when we receive Jesus, we also receive the blessing of having our sins blotted out. He also says that they would be refreshed. He says, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. It's interesting, the Greek word for refreshing has the idea of the times of rest or the times of respite or the times of relief or refreshment. You see, God doesn't wipe away our sins without giving us relief or rest in our souls. In fact, that's what Jesus said during his earthly ministry. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus' invitation today is still come. Come unto me. If you need rest for your souls, if you need to be unburdened, now is the time to come. Now imagine these people facing the fact that they were responsible for the murder of Jesus. Jesus and being confronted by the fact that Peter says you need to realize that you murdered Jesus, but that same Jesus who you murdered wants to unburden you from your sin. That's in essence what Peter was saying, and that they would experience Jesus' kingdom. Notice what the Bible says, and he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom heaven must receive until the time of restitution of all things, which God hath spoken by the mouth of all of the holy prophets since the world began. Jesus is coming again. The angel in Acts chapter 1 had just told the disciples that Jesus was coming again, so get busy witnessing. And Peter now explains that Jesus is coming again and will restore all things. It doesn't take us very long to realize that our world is broken down. It's broken. It's full of broken people with broken lives and broken situations. We see the effects of sin on a daily basis as we view natural disasters. I can't remember what, I think it was Dubai, had 20 people killed last week because of torrential rains. Who would imagine that people would be killed by rain in Dubai? It's a desert. But because of flash flooding, 20 people or more were killed last week because of this natural disaster. It's getting upon us that we're going to have hurricane season in the Atlantic and in the Pacific, and there will be hurricanes and tropical storms, and no doubt some people will die as a result of that, and there'll be tsunamis at some point and other things that will happen, and all of those things, natural disasters and sicknesses and cancer, and sometimes the personal choices of others are a result of sin entering our world. Creation even feels the effects of sin today, whereas the Bible says the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together right now. The world yearns, the world aches on a day-by-day basis as a result of sin and the effects of sin. But there's coming a day when Jesus is going to make all things new. Now, this must have touched a button with the religious leaders that were present. And so we see the response to the message. First of all, the religious leaders reacted and imprisoned Peter and John. The Bible says, "And as they spake unto the people, the priest and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on them and put them in the hold or until the prison until the next day, for it was now eventide or evening." The Jewish leaders present could have repented. They could have come to faith in Jesus. But what Peter said struck a nerve in their hearts, because they were the ones that gave the nod to put Jesus to death. They were resistant to take any responsibility in what had happened to Jesus so they could maintain their own power, and they were grieved that Peter preached about the resurrection of the dead. So they grabbed him and they put him in prison. And then we see the people repented. Notice what the Bible says. It says, "Howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of men was about 5,000. Now, that doesn't include the women. But it says the men that believed were 5,000. Now, you would have thought that 3,000 people coming to faith at Pentecost was an aberration. But God allowed the miracle of this lame man being healed and Peter's message to bring about 5,000 more men coming to faith in Jesus Christ. And here's what I want to say. When Jesus is lifted up, when Jesus becomes the focus, when Jesus is the center of our lives in our homes, he brings all men to himself. And so my encouragement to you this morning is to continue to lift up the name of Jesus. If you teach your children, if you teach your teenagers, if you teach your family, if you have an opportunity to share Christ with friends, always make sure that you're making much of Jesus. You're making much of Jesus. A man's life was forever changed by the power of Jesus Christ. God allowed a beautiful miracle to take place, and no one could deny it. Peter didn't use it as an opportunity to elevate himself, but Peter used it as an opportunity to elevate Jesus and to preach about him. As people recognized what was done in what they did in crucifying Jesus and who needed to be their Messiah, 5,000 people responded and were saved, while the religious elite became inflamed. And again, I want to say this: Jesus has the power to change men's lives today. My friend who passed away was a gentleman's gentleman. And the first time he shared his testimony with me, he told me, he said, "You know, Pastor," he said, "I used to be a pothead." And I looked at him and I said, "Victor," I said, "You're lying to me." He said, "No, Pastor, I used to be a pothead." And he said, if God wouldn't have gotten hold of me, I'd have been in far worse trouble than that. But God saved me and he delivered me and he put me on a new road. He put a new song in my heart. And God changed that man. And hearing the testimonies of others about his joy and his love for his Savior was encouraging to me. God changed his life, and other lives were changed as a result. God changed this man's life, the lame man's life, and other lives were changed as a result. 5,000 people came to Jesus Christ. God changed my life. And other people have come to faith as a result. And God wants to continue to change our lives. So let's make much of Jesus. Every head bowed and every eye closed. As we've gathered here this morning, we understand that the book of Acts is about the Acts of the Apostles. The book of Acts often centers about people coming to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ and their lives changing as a result. That should be our testimony. When we've come to Jesus Christ, our lives are changed as a result. And we should desire to see the lives of others changed as a result. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed and no one's looking around. I want to ask one question first and then another. I want to ask this morning, I wonder who might be here who doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. I wonder who would say, Pastor, that's me. I'm not sure. I'm a believer. And God is speaking to me about that. And I need some prayer. If that's you, I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to call any attention to you. I'd like to know who you are so I could pray for you. Is there anyone like that with an uplifted hand, heads bowed and eyes closed? Anyone at all? I wonder who would say this. Pastor, as you were speaking today, God was speaking to me about something. And as a Christian, I need some prayer. If that's you, could I pray for you with an uplifted hand this morning? Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for who you are and what you've done for us in giving us Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that you'd help us and guide us and direct us further into your truth. And Lord, help us to always be cognizant, to not lift up ourselves, but to lift up the name of Jesus.
God, thank you so much for this chapter that you've given to us. And thank you for the many, many truths that were spoken this morning. And I pray that you would allow some of that to embed itself in our hearts. And Lord, I pray that you would continue to speak and work through the book of Acts as we're going through it. And thank you for what you did this morning in our hearts and then in the hearts of people who have trusted you and followed in believers' baptism. And Lord, we thank you for how you are blessing and you're working in people's lives. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, thank you for coming this morning. If there's any way we can be a help to you, please let us know. If you see someone that got baptized this morning, just give them a little congrats on the way out. If this is your first time here, thank you for being here. And we would love to give you a gift in our guest services after the service. Have a great Sunday. We'll see you guys next week.
I see the darkness tremble at the ground below us. And in the